Good morning. It's my privilege to welcome you to worship on this beautiful November 15th, 2020. It's great to see you here. A part of my joy each week is watching folks begin to assemble here in the Peachtree Room in an age when we're still somewhat distanced, but we're finding ways to smile behind the mask and share stories and communicate with one another. And if you've joined us online, we especially welcome you as our honored guest. If you're watching online, we'd love to know who you are and where you're watching from. If you would take a moment to share a greeting or post a picture on social media, it would encourage us and let us know what's going on with you and your family. If you're new to Wieuca, either gathered here in the room or you're here online this morning, we invite you to text the word welcome to the number on the screen, and we would look forward to sharing a note of appreciation with you. If you are gathered with us in the Peachtree Room, you could also find a hard copy guest information card located in the seat in front of you. And if you would fill that out and drop it in the basket or give it to a staff member following the service, we'll look forward to keeping up with what's going on in your life. During these days, as we continue worshiping in person, we invite you to continue to share your prayer updates and prayer concerns with us. You can text the word pray to the number on the screen. And as always, we appreciate your generous and faithful giving, which energizes and fuels our ministries each week. You can text the word give to set up an online giving account. And then if you would like to join with us in worship and work and service here, we invite you to text the word join, and one of our staff members will be in touch with you to talk about your membership here at Wieuca. Following today's service, you're welcome to stay behind and meet with one of our ministers or one of our greeters who can share a membership card with you. But if you're watching online, text the word join to the number on the screen. This is an exciting day. It's not only a beautiful day, it's a day where we're beginning our children's worship. We have a safe and spacious environment for them, so following the children's message this morning, the children are invited to go with Miss Angie to the children's worship area. Also, following today's service, we'll have a brief quarterly church in conference. We'll pause after the service so any of our guests who would like to depart may do so, and then we'll begin rather promptly so we can get home for lunch, but look forward to sharing in our church in conference. Now let's continue to prepare for important moments of worship. Victoria is going to come and call us to worship this morning.
God, our Father, God, our Mother, God, our friend and our sustainer. To the God who has called us to worship, we welcome you to this place. We welcome you to do whatever you want to do. We welcome you to say whatever you want to say, and we welcome you to move however you want to move. Our hearts are open and our minds are ready to experience you today. As we worship, we pray for divine God winks, that something would remind us that you are not only present in this place, in this worship service, but in our lives as well. Remind us that our lives are never-ending worship services. We welcome you, God, and we are excited about your presence. And all that is done here today, whether in word or in deed or in the meditation of our hearts, we will do so proclaiming your name. Come, let us worship.
How can I say thanks for the things you have done for me? Deserved, yet you'd give to prove your love for me. The voices of a million angels could not express my gratitude. All that I am and ever hope to be,
to God be the glory.
Counselor, Comforter, King. Spirit, we long to embrace. You offer hope when our hearts have hopelessly lost the way. Oh, we hopelessly lost the way. You are the one that we praise. You are the one we adore. You give the healing and grace. Our hearts always
this morning, I brought with me a book, not just my Bible. I brought with me my math book and my pencil. I don't know about your house, but we do a lot of math at my house because we have homework still. And I don't know if you've ever said that phrase, I just can't. Have you ever said that? I bet a couple of you have. Of course, at some time or another, we've all said that. Maybe it was when the soccer coach asked you to take a penalty shot for the team. Or maybe it was when your piano teacher asked you to play some hard piano piece. Or maybe it was when your teacher asked you to do a book report in front of the entire class and you thought, oh, I just can't. Well, let me tell you a little story about Jacob. Jacob was a very good student. Oh, he wasn't really the smartest kid in the class, but he worked hard and he made some good grades. But his worst or hardest subject was math. Addition and subtraction didn't give him a whole lot of trouble, but when it came to long division, he just did not get it. One day, he opened up his math book, and he threw his pencil down, and he cried out in frustration, I just can't do it. And his teacher, Mrs. Davis, said, and she smiled as she said it, can't never could do anything. Here, let me help you. And Mrs. Davis went over to Jacob's desk, and showed him step by step what he had to do to solve those problems. With his teacher's help, suddenly long division wasn't so difficult for him. Today, Dr. Berry is going to talk to us about an Old Testament fella named Jeremiah. And one day, God spoke to Jeremiah and said, "Before you were born, I chose you to be a prophet to all the nations." But get a load of what Jeremiah might have said. "I can't." Kind of like Jacob said, "I can't." "I can't. I'm not a good speaker. And besides, I'm too young." And here's kind of a paraphrase, maybe, from what God said. "Don't say I can't. If I tell you to go and speak to someone, then go. And if I tell you what to say, then don't leave out a word." Then the Lord reached out his hand and touched Jeremiah's mouth and said, "I am giving you the words to say, and I am sending you with authority to speak to the nations for me." There will be times in our life when God comes and tells you to do something like he did to Jeremiah, and he asks you to do something special. Maybe it's being a preacher or a Sunday school teacher or a missionary, or maybe telling your friend at school about Jesus. Whatever it is God calls you to do this to do in your life, remember what he said to Jeremiah. Don't say I can't. I want to challenge you with this scripture verse, boys and girls. It's from Jeremiah chapter 1, 7 and 8. "But the Lord said to me, do not say, I am only a child. You must go to everyone I send you to and say whatever I commanded you. Do not be afraid of them, for I am with you and will rescue you, declares the Lord." So remember, boys and girls, be brave, be strong, and remember, can't never could do anything. Let's talk to God together. There may be times, dear Lord, that we are afraid of things in this life, and God, that we think we can't do things, but we know that if we ask you to do something, you will help us, that you give us the abilities to trust in you. God, help us to remember these words. It's in your name that we pray. Amen. Boys and girls, I invite you to come with me. We're going to go right down the hall and have children's worship together. So as we sing these words, boys and girls, I'll meet you right over here.
To God.
Today comes from Colossians 3:15-17. "Let the peace of Christ rule in your hearts, since as members of one body you were called to peace, and be thankful. Let the message of Christ dwell among you richly as you teach and admonish one another with all wisdom through psalms, hymns, and songs from the Spirit, singing to God with gratitude in your hearts. And whatever you do, whether in word or deed, do it all in the name of the Lord Jesus, giving thanks to God the Father through him." This is the word of the Lord.
Psalm 100, verse 4, tells us to enter into his gates with thanksgiving and into his courts with praise. Give thanks to him and praise his name. Will you pray with me, please? Dear God, we come today with grateful hearts to praise you for all gifts. You have brought us through a difficult year. We thank you for leading us through the good things and through the hard things. We're thankful for those who have kept us safe and who have worked to heal those who have experienced pain and suffering. Forgive us when we fail to thank you for who you are, for all that you've given, and for all that you do for us. We are thankful that we can come together to worship. We ask for your wisdom, your strength, and power to be present with us, and help us to honor you in all that we do. May we live in such a way that others will be drawn to you. Help us to see the needs of others at this Thanksgiving season. Help us to be generous and kind to all that we meet. May the fruits of the Spirit be evident in our lives. Your love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, and self-control. Thank you for your love and your care for us. We pray in your name. Amen.
Was lost, but now I'm found. I once was lost, but now I'm found. So far away, but I'm home now. I once was lost, but now I'm found. And now my life song sings. I once was blind, but now I see. I once was blind, but now I see. I didn't know how, but when he touched me, once was blind, but now I see. And now my life song sings. And now my life song sings. And now my life song sings. I once was dead. Was dead, but now I live. Now my life to you I give. Now my life to you I give. Now my life to you I give.
In 1752, a young man that had a troubled youth, he was disenfranchised by his own family, joined gangs, attended a service led by George Whitefield, and went into the service with all intent to heckle and create problems. He heard the sermon, and the power of God fell upon him and changed his life, changed the song of the world to become a life song of love and service. The man's name was Robert Robertson, who wrote this next song. And if there is a heart song, a life song for us, perhaps we can identify with the last verse, "Oh, to grace, how great a debtor. Daily I'm constrained to be. Let thy grace, Lord, like a fetter, bind my wandering heart to thee," because we're all prone to wander. "Lord, I feel it, prone to leave the God I love. Here's my heart. Take and seal it. Seal it for thy courts above." Let's stand together as we sing. Come thou fount of every blessing,
at some point between 630 and 580 BC, Jeremiah was called to be a prophet. And his prophecy was probably recorded on parchment and fragments, and later pieced together in the edition we find in our scriptures today. In just a moment, I want to read a segment, a small segment, but a thematic segment from Jeremiah's prophecy in chapter 20, verses 7 through 11. Before I read the passage, let me again thank you for being here, to thank the vocalist for helping lead us in congregational singing, to thank Brock for the beautiful reflective piece. I have the privilege this morning, so many good things. I'm standing above the world's largest cornucopia, created by our own Steve Ray, thank you, looking at the most outstanding mask congregation anyone in this community has the privilege of standing before. And it didn't escape my notice, and I hope it didn't escape yours, that this is the largest number of children that we've seen since the last Sunday of February. And we were able to get the entire parcel out in one chorus. But here's what's going to happen as we continue to reach new families and as the next baby boom occurs. It'll take at least a verse in a chorus and later two verses in a chorus. And mark my word, in about 2 years from now, we'll be singing three stanzas to get all the children out to children's church. And exciting things are happening here in Wieuca. In Jeremiah chapter 20, verses 7 through 11, it's confusing because it's a very lamentuous confession that Jeremiah makes, almost a complaint against God. And then he moves to articulating his dilemma, and then he moves into this acclamation that everything's going to be okay. So listen for those movements in these short verses. Beginning in verse 7, "You deceived me, Lord, and I was deceived. You overpowered me and prevailed. I am ridiculed all day long, and everyone mocks me. Whenever I speak, I cry out, proclaiming violence and destruction. So the word of the Lord has brought me insult and reproach all day long. But I say, I will not mention his word or speak any more his name. His word is in my heart like a fire shut up in my bones. I am weary of holding it in. Indeed, I cannot. I hear many whispering, terror on every side. Denounce him, let's denounce him. All my friends are waiting for me to slip, saying, perhaps he will be deceived, then we will prevail over him and take our revenge on him. But the Lord is with me like a mighty warrior, so my persecutors will stumble and not prevail. They will fail and be thoroughly disgraced. Their dishonor will never be forgotten." In our brief moments this morning, I want to mention a little quote I heard some time ago from Tim Tebow. I want to say a few words about the downside and the inside and the upside of Jeremiah's message to the people of Judah. If time permits, I want to share a brief historical story about what happened during the time of President Woodrow Wilson, and I want to dare to close with a brief anecdote that Bill Self told me about that happened when he and Carolyn went to Europe several years ago. But first, let me ask, what is the biggest passion in your life? Where does your motivation come from? What is your purpose in being? Tim Tebow once said, "When we talk about having a life of significance and meaning, it's not about fame or money or resources. It's about people and lives and hearts." That's my biggest passion in life, Tebow says. When it comes to Jeremiah, even though Jeremiah faced tremendous adversity, Jeremiah says, "I had a fire in my bones." For those who've experienced that kind of passion and that kind of motivation, when it goes away, how do you reignite it? Jeremiah had a passion in his bones. It was a source of motivation. He was determined to share the love and grace of God with his actions and his words. This story from Jeremiah happens to fall during the Thanksgiving season. Every one of us of every age need passion and purpose in life, a driving force that motivates us to do the right thing. a force that motivates us to serve with our best gifts. I'm convinced that even gratitude, God-given gratitude, can lead us to revisit the meaning of life and reignite our motivation to love living life God's way. By the way, if you felt like you were in the doldrums, if you felt like you've been living in a haze, if you felt like there's a giant fog cast over your life, be aware that there is such a thing that you read about in the paper, but it's real, COVID brain. Some call it pandemic fatigue, that you just all of a sudden can't see clearly at all. You can't think and process as clearly as you want. Some experience the grief effect. Maybe the grief is related. Maybe it's residual grief from the past. But grief also casts a fog or a cloud over our lives, which is one of the reasons we should never make major decisions. Our faculties of discernment are dimmed when we're under the influence of the grief effect. Or maybe, dare I add, that you may be experiencing either politics overload or a political hangover. And it doesn't matter who you voted for, but you had so much adrenaline going into the thinking and acting and reacting that right now you're just drained. Or maybe it's just the malaise of your own personal sin. And that was really what Jeremiah was addressing, that the people had become so prosperous that they had forgotten about God, that they had everything under control, so much so that they needed no guidance. So for just a moment, think with me about the downside and then the inside and then the upside. First of all, there's a downside to Jeremiah's message. You can tell that he is quite frustrated with his relationship with God. He had to come to terms with the downside. Jeremiah's message was a call for the people of Judah to change their behavior to please God, and it didn't go over well. Anytime you talk to people about changing their behavior, realigning their priorities, the older I get, the more difficult change becomes. I understand why. Through the years, I couldn't understand why older people didn't want to change anything. I don't want my toothbrush moved. And Jeremiah is talking about people realigning their values and their priorities to coincide with God, and the people didn't respond very well. Anytime a prophet calls on people to change their attitude, realign their motives, change their behavior, there is a tension in the air, and Jeremiah is struggling with that tension. This was a time when Judah was prosperous and stable. But in their prosperity, they began to tailor their lives around pleasure and comfort rather than God's mission. And they began to pay lip service to God. That's what Jeremiah says, that they talked about God, but what they said about God and how they lived their life were two different things. So Jeremiah called them to repent, and they saw him, the prophet, the preacher, as a nuisance. He was out of date. He was a religious protagonist who didn't understand the real world. Jeremiah's message made them uncomfortable, and they lashed out at him. They not only rebelled, but the scripture says they mocked Jeremiah and tried to have him silenced. And so that's what it means in verse 8 when Jeremiah, in his pain and agony, on the downside, says, "The word of the Lord has brought me insult and reproach all day long." But it's not all the downside. There's the inside. There was something welling up in Jeremiah, which beckons us and invites us to take a closer look at the inside of our own life. What is it we're being called to do? Where is the fire of our passion? What is it that makes our soul sing? From where does our motivation come? Jeremiah's motivation was internal and not external. Jeremiah found himself in the pits of despair, but his motivation could not be extinguished, even in the valley. No wonder it says in Jeremiah chapter 20, verse 9 in the message, "Forget it, no more God messages for me," but then he goes on to confess, "The words are like a fire in my belly, a burning in my bones. I try to hold it in, and I can't do it any longer." By the way, let me add that this is not just true for those of us who are believers who maybe feel called to do something. to teach, to practice law, to enter business, to be a professor, to work with children, to be a pastor, to be a missionary. It's certainly true that we want to have a fire in our bones, and that fire can occasionally have cold water thrown on it. I'm convinced that internally, the Spirit of God precedes us in any faith conversation, where early in my ministry, I thought it was up to me to prize open the human heart and plant that seed, whether they wanted it to be planted or not. Evangelism by force. But what I've discovered is that God is usually working in someone's heart and mind and thoughts long before I ever arrive on the scene, and I'm entering a conversation that's already underway, and what I'm adding is a brief word of encouragement, so the onus is not on me. The onus is on the Spirit of God that is already internally motivating people to think about God, to respond to God, to obey God, and to align their lives with God. These stories from Jeremiah cause us to stop and think about motivation. Where does it come from? What's the difference between internal and external motivation? Let me suggest that external motivation aims for the trophy, while internal motivation aims for transformation. That external motivation goes for the crown, while internal motivation is all about character. That external motivation is for personal gain, and internal motivation is about personal growth. External motivation is content with mere lip service religion, but internal motivation thrives on personal relationship with God. You see, when it comes to responding to God, external motivation is about convenience and comfort, while internal motivation is about faithfulness and obedience. Internal motivation is there when the cheering stops. Remember the story of Palm Sunday? We talked about it in spring when Jesus entered Jerusalem to the cheering of the crowds, and perhaps those same voices were jeering rather than cheering by the end of the week. When Jesus entered Jerusalem, it was easy to sing Hosanna with a cheering crowd, but what happened when the cheering stopped? Years ago, Gene Smith, an American historian, authored a book entitled When the Cheering Stopped. But it isn't about Jesus' entry into Jerusalem. You see, it's about Woodrow Wilson and the events surrounding the conclusion of World War I. Toward the end of the war, people were extremely optimistic. They believed that the last war in history had been fought. The dream was that the world had at last been made safe and the way paved clear for democracy and freedom everywhere. So when Woodrow Wilson paid his first visit to Europe, he was greeted by large crowds and cheered every place he went. In many people's eyes, he was more popular than the greatest war heroes throughout the world. And he was viewed among many around the world as an icon of hope. In all, the cheering lasted maybe for 1 year, and then it began to fade until it came to a complete stop. The political leaders throughout Europe were interested more in their own agendas than a lasting peace, and hope began to diminish for this lasting peace and freedom. And on the home front in our country, Wilson met opposition from the Senate. His League of Nations idea was never ratified. He was under tremendous stress. His health began to fail. His party lost the election. And Woodrow Wilson, who almost 2 years earlier had been heralded around the world as a hero, came to his last days a broken and defeated man. This is how Gene Smith summarized the biography of Woodrow Wilson, because when the cheering stopped, the motivation went away. Passion and purpose in life seldom emerge from money in the bank, diplomas on the wall, or they seldom emerge from trophies on the shelf. Mission and meaning converge daily in the lives of the people we encounter, in the opportunities that we choose to embrace, and in the challenges of life that we tackle. On the days we want to quit, on the days we want to give up, on the days we want to forsake our calling, there is a spark within, much like a pilot light in the deep south, that reclaims us and reminds us of who we are and whose we are and what we are called to do with the gifts we've been given. Which leads finally to the upside. The downside, for sure, there's an element of ridicule. The inside, there's this turmoil, but there's a calling, there's a spark. There's a passion that just won't go away. But in the upside, Jeremiah concluded that whatever I face, no matter how tough the circumstances, in verse 11 he summarized, "The Lord is with me like a mighty warrior, so my persecutors will stumble and not prevail." We all know that Jeremiah's message was ultimately fulfilled in the life of Jesus himself. In Jeremiah 31, at the conclusion of his ministry, Jeremiah summarized, "This is the covenant I will make with the people of Israel after that time, declares the Lord. I will put my law in their minds. I will write it on their hearts. I will be their God, and they will be my people. No longer will they teach their neighbor, say to one another, 'Know the Lord,' but all people will know me, from the least of them to the greatest of them. For I will forgive their wickedness, and I will remember their sins no more." However you are processing this strange year, especially if you are experiencing a roller coaster ride of emotions and motivation, you can be sure that this is a time for the embers to be stirred and the flames of faith to be stoked in your heart and mind, and to let the fire in your bones be reignited so that it motivates you to faithfully follow the footsteps and the teachings of Jesus himself. I mentioned Bill Self and Carolyn. Some of you in this room remember them all too well. And the story would not surprise you that years ago when Bill and Carolyn went to Hong Kong, they had a long flight from Atlanta. They were tired. Bill says we were extremely grungy and disheveled when we arrived. So after a little bit of rest, Carolyn insisted that she go to see the hairdresser in our hotel. But when we got there, Carolyn noticed that in Hong Kong, the hairdresser had a beautiful cross hanging around her neck. And Carolyn said, "Oh, that's a beautiful cross. I guess you're a Christian." To which the hairdresser pointed and said, This is just for fun." And we live in an age when, like the hairdresser in Hong Kong, we put on our religious attire just for fun. Jeremiah says, "There's a fire in my bones that cannot be extinguished." We believe that our deepest motives are God-given and not self-generated. If you're a crossroads in your life this morning and you want to take a deeper dive in what it means to be a follower of Jesus, we would love the opportunity to be your conversation partner. If you're here in the Peachtree Room this morning, we'd love you to stay after the service and we'll share in an important conversation. But if you're watching online, call the number on the screen and one of our ministers will return your call. And we would look forward to talking to you about what it means to start and continue a journey of faith. Now, as we prepare to sing our prayer, the words to "I Surrender All" in just a few moments, would you join me in this prayer? May we pray together. Our most gracious God, may the words of our mouths and the meditations and motives in our hearts be acceptable unto you, for you are indeed our strength and our Redeemer. And all the people said, amen.
Love and trust Him in His presence.
Lord, rekindle that fire, that when we leave this place today, we will go out changed to be your people, to bless others. Amen. Please be seated.
In just a moment, John is going to come and lead us in our closing song, but before he does, I want to take just a moment to say thank you for joining us either in this room or either online today for this worship experience. It's so good to be together, and I'm so glad that you have chosen to come, and I hope it's been a blessing to you to be in this place today to hear God's word proclaimed. And if this was your first time to join us, we especially want to extend a warm welcome to you, and I invite you to come and join us again next time. Following our worship service today, we will have church and conference. Our pastor's already alluded to that. We'll take a short stand-up break, and then we'll reconvene in just a few moments. But this will give you an opportunity to speak to our guests who are in the room, and then stay and do the business of the church here in just a few moments. Also today at 4 o'clock is our fall family fun on the play porch. We'll enjoy some games, enjoy the playground, and do some family crafts as well. And we can even roast some s'mores. Yummy. I get hungry thinking about it. So bring along chair and or blankets to sit on, and be sure to RSVP to Angie. Our youth are going to have a skate night in the gym this Friday evening from 6:30 until 8 o'clock. There'll be Chick-fil-A and snacks that'll be provided, and facial coverings will be required. And again, RSVP to Victoria for that event. All of us would be quick to say that we enjoy so much the beautiful decorations that are done in our building every year. The decorating committee just does a fabulous job making our rooms look beautiful. And that will be coming up again next Sunday, November 22nd. It's the big day for decking the halls and all of that. So if you would like to be a part of that experience and helping to decorate, there is a place for you. So be sure to contact Mary Jane Harris for more information about that. We want to thank you for the wonderful way that you are supporting the ministries of this church, being involved in furthering God's kingdom here on this place. So we want to encourage you to continue to give. There's places at the front and at the exits so that you can drop your offering there, or any of the other ways that you we have normally done, by texting the number GIVE, the word GIVE, to the number that you see on the screen right now, using your bank's bill pay or mailing a check, whatever it is, any of those work. So I hope that you'll continue to be faithful in supporting God's work here at Wieuca. Now, would you stand with us as John comes to lead us in our closing song?
Sing my soul.
Serve the Lord.